This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Stay tuned to the end for more info. Also, this movie features an incredible amount of blood and gore. And, well, it's YouTube and I don't want it to get demonetized, and it's also sponsored, so I'm gonna do my best to censor stuff with Ryan from High School Musical. And so I crashed on the path when I'm lying in bed, just to get it all out what's in my head. And welcome back to my Netflix original periodical evaluation series, or NOPE for short, or EPON for short if you say it backwards. You see, I love horror movies. Movies like The Evil Dead, Halloween, and Happy Feet are incredibly spooky tales that I hold very dearly in my heart. They can be funny, scary, or gory. All of it's amazing. Last year, this Netflix original known as The Babysitter dropped, and on my 2017 list, I gave it a 2 out of 10, which was actually quite harsh. It should have been a 1 out of 10. Nah, I'm kidding. It should have been a 0 out of 10. Nah, I'm still playing. It should have been a 5.2. It's definitely not unbearable like The Kissing Booth.
Truth or dare.
Dare!
But it tries way, way too hard to be cool, and it's incredibly distracting. Every second of it just wants to throw something in your face to impress you. But it comes off like a little kid screaming at you, hey, I can do this thing, look at me, I can do this thing. My first thought was to check out the director behind the project, and it turns out to be Mick Jagger directed the film. Good ol' McDonald's. What kind of name is Mick G? Sounds like an infection. You'll be pleased to find out that the film stars two of the greatest internet personalities to ever exist, King Bach and Bella Thorne in my ass. These two can't act to save a life, and you'll see just how bad. The movie stars this kid who is totally not prepubescent Dan DeHaan, and his fight against a bunch of Satanist teens and shit. They're all out for his blood, but, you know, he likes his blood, so he wants it to stay in there. The main girl he's battling is the babysitter Samara Weaving, who is really the only saving grace of the film. Her name in the movie is Bee, and I don't know how she got involved with this Bee movie. She has way more talent than this movie deserves. So the movie starts with this little Ken doll getting picked on by some bullies.
Really?
Well, you see, as a 14-year-old in that kind of situation with a 16-year-old that looks like Shelley McIntyre?
We, as a viewer, are supposed to assume he's a massive nerd because he tucks in his shirt and wears glasses, when in reality, he looks like a poster child of Old Navy. There is nothing stereotypically nerdy about his appearance. So while he's getting picked on, Goddess Athena comes in over here to try to save his ass by threatening one of the bullies with the hardest threat.
Plastic. Talking to a plastic plant.
So she drops him at home, and we get very obvious foreshadowing. Here, 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 and here. His dad takes him to teach him how to drive, and I'm sorry, but this man looks like a thumb. So it turns out the parents are going away because they want to fuck! So little Ken doll here needs BB to babysit him. For some distracting and dumb reason, the camera goes first person very randomly without a purpose for a moment. And then we get a montage of the two hanging out together while she babysits him. We also get a lot of in-your-face text on screen that are just so annoying and pointless. You'll see that throughout the movie, they add in some weird text to seem cool, but all it does is take you out of the film. It adds absolutely nothing to this movie. In a movie like Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, the text on screen adds so much to the humor and aesthetic in the world, because it's a part of the world itself, because the world has no rules. But here in The Babysitter, it just throws in text randomly to seem cool or tell you exactly what to think at a certain time. And for a while, it completely forgets the flashy text until like the last scene. Like, at least be consistent with your annoyances. So these two have one big nerdy talk about pop culture fights to make it seem like they're connecting in some way when this kid is just so terrible at acting.
Yeah, so there's an epic villain, right?
Right.
Okay, so you have to fill a starship full of the best people, or aliens, or robots
to take them down.
This girl is giving it her absolute all to make this terrible writing work.
Because that's her move. But she knows she gotta do this because it's the only way to save the world.
The universe.
Right, exactly!
So BB tells Ken doll to go to bed in exchange for a shot of alcohol, but he's too much of a little bitch to drink it, so he drowns out the plant and BB tucks him in bed. For some reason, he cries like a little bitch boy he is, and he texts his neighbor girl about the babysitter and they talk about some adult-related activities. Little Kendall sneaks outside to see that BB has friends over who are playing Spin the Bottle. We get a big introduction to all the stereotypical teens that the film can think of, which, okay. So the film tries really hard to play the tropes of classic horror tales by purposefully introducing a bunch of cliches and stereotypes, but it doesn't do anything special with it, or even pull some kind of twist. Like, it's self-aware enough to include these classic horror tropes on purpose, but it doesn't go any farther, and it stays completely surface level, which is very disappointing. We get an epic esports level challenge during the Spin the Bottle, and BB lands some kisses on the others.
I dare you to kiss everyone here.
Oh, okay. Y'all rehearsed this.
Then as she gets to the nerd of the group, she crawls up all sexy, leans in real close, and stabs him hard as hell through the skull with two massive knives. First off, that just shows how strong this girl is. Do you know how hard a human skull is? It's pretty frickin' hard, dude. Pretty frickin' hard! So the camera cuts the default Thrillville character, and on the screen pops the words, "What the fuck?" which I absolutely hate. I have never hated a series of three words more than right here. It's annoying, it has zero point, and all it does is take you out of the film for a moment instead of staying immersed. So we then get some, ooh, delicious comedy from King Bach, getting spurted with a lot of blood.
Wait, hold on, my shit ain't working. I think it went out of blood or something.
Oh wait, I mean cranberry juice, okay? You hear me, YouTube? But this is cranberry juice. Here, Bella Thorne tries really hard to act like a stereotypical popular girl, but it's just terrible.
I just came from a game, that's why I'm wearing this, obviously. I was not gonna miss this. Look at this shit. That would go viral so hard. I mean, nobody's done human sacrifice.
People have always done human sacrifice.
Yeah, but like, not in America with hot people.
You can't act, Bella. Just give it up. Shake it up. Go watch up. Just do something else. You know what? This performance is actually amazing. She genuinely feels like her character since the character does not want to be there, and it's clear Bella did not care about being there either. So Kendall runs to his room to call the cops and he grabs a pocket knife. And we get more text on screen and ugh. I just hate it so much. He gets in bed to act like he's asleep since they all come upstairs and they take some of his juicy cranberry juice. King Bach gives you yet another example into what real comedy is.
Do you know what happens when you kill someone?
They lose like all their Instagram followers.
Oh my god, that would suck.
So when the teens leave, Thrillville character gets up out of bed and tries to escape through the window, but ends up passing out. He wakes up tied to a chair. Once again, we get some unneeded annoying text. Stop trying to be cool, movie. The cops show up and we get a scene that I really, really like and really, really hate. This is a common theme. Half genuine good horror comedy tropes and terrible ways at ruining it.
Titty gone! Titty gone! Don't you move! Keep your hands up! Don't you move! Oh! Don't you move!
Hey, chill with the gun, stop, man. Chill. You Mexican, right? Look, I speak Spanish. Lo siento, my nigga. Lo siento.
I love how this dude's partner gets a spear through his head, but he still doesn't open fire, and then Bach ruins it. Then I really love that they try to kill off Bella, but then again, it's ruined because she's still alive. So once these two cops fucking die, Kendall escapes upstairs, leading to Bach to slip on some foreshadowed Hot Wheels and fucking die. So Kendall hides underneath his house with a firework and the artsy beret girl comes in randomly acting all psycho. But Kendall tells her a funny joke. He's like, "Hey, where did Mary go after that explosion?" And she's like, "I don't know, where?" And he's just like, "Everywhere!" Soon Hunk Beefcake McHunk comes in to chase after Kendall, leading to a very drawn out chase until they arrive at a broken treehouse. And somehow, He falls through the floor into a rope that manages to tie itself perfectly around his neck and create a knot in order for him to get hanged and fucking die. Thrillville default character runs to his neighbor's house real quick for a quick kiss-kiss, then goes right back to his house to see that Bella Thorne is still sadly alive. BB repeats the same exact Mary joke on Bella Thorne's head, and Ken Doll threatens to burn her Book of Mormon. Oh yeah, there's this Satanist Book of Mormon in the movie that's like the motivation for these teens wanting to sacrifice nerds, but you never really learn anything about it, and it's fucking stupid. So Ken Doll sets a book on fire and suicide bombs his own house with pinpoint accuracy into BB. The car is seemingly on top of her, but like, she's completely fine. With some butter and a little wiggle room, she can pop right out of there. The cops show up and it's GG. Ken Doll beat the stupid teens and won. The end. This film leaves me really conflicted. There are things I really like about the film. I love the abundance of gore and violence, and there are great comedic moments sprinkled throughout amongst the awful writing.
Why is he shirtless?
That's your first question?
The main babysitter's performance is really, really good here, and she deserves a much better role than this film gives her.
What's the blood for?
You mix the blood of the innocent with the blood of someone sacrificed. Recite the verses while dripping it on the page. And basically you get whatever you want.
I hope she gets a chance to be in more things besides this movie, but that's really all I like. Because for everything I start to like in this movie, it gets instantly ruined. They forget the babysitter exists for like 40 minutes towards the end of the movie, and for every good joke, there's 300 bad ones. And when I start to love the violent action, it's undercut with very cringy editing and terrible camera work that tries to impress you more than rather actually being impressive itself. Throughout the movie, the director is trying to desperately shock and awe you with cool camera work, when it really just seems forced and amateur. For a moment, you think that the film is trying to take horror cliches and play them with a cheeky way, but it does nothing with them at all. I could only think of a much better film that did everything in this film, but that's actually good. I highly recommend The Final Girls. A 2015 movie where these teens are trapped inside a stereotypical slasher film. The movie is full of cheeky ways to play on the cliches of a horror film, and the camera work is actually incredible. It's basically like the dude from The Babysitter saw how fantastic the camera work was in this movie and failed so hard at trying to attempt its style. It even has text on screen, but it actually makes sense within the world because it's part of the slasher film's credits, and it's very, very funny at times. So, you know, please check this movie out. It does everything The Babysitter tries to do, but does it so much better. Babysitter is full of god-awful editing and camera work, and honestly, they could have done so much better with a few classes from Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community for creators with more than 17,000 creative business, technology, and lifestyle classes. You can find classes on film production and editing, and I bet if the people behind The Babysitter watched a few of these classes from Skillshare, they would have upped their game immensely. A premium membership gives you unlimited access to high-quality classes from experts working in their fields, so you can improve your skills, unlock new opportunities, and do the work that you love. Skillshare is also more affordable than any of the other learning platforms out there. An annual subscription is just less than $10 a month. It's thanks to sponsors like Skillshare that I'm able to afford 2 High School Musical Blu-rays instead of just 1, because that would be sad. The effect you saw earlier in the video was actually something I very quickly learned from an After Effects course in Skillshare. Everything was incredibly clear and easy to follow, and I highly recommend you watch it. The first 500 people to use my link in the description can get 2 months of Skillshare Premium for free. Then it's just as low as $10 a month after if you decide to continue learning using Skillshare. I might send over that link to Mick G so he could learn some stuff. I also just want to give a quick shout out to YT Thunder, Riley Gosnell, Charlie Bidgood, Christian St. Croix, Scott Idols, Mike Nelson, Brad Pepper, Pedro, Destiny Matheny, Xavier Palladio, Pravakin, Freddy, Piff Pack Pierre, and Peachy Dolly for their amazing support on Patreon, as well as to all the other amazing Patreons that are supporting me on Patreon. And thanks so much for watching.